Good evening.
The biggest event in the Irish literary calendar is just about to get underway.
Tonight we welcome the publishers, booksellers and of course the authors who've given us such fascinating books to read over the past 12 months.
Now many of them have already claimed their place amongst the world's literary giants. But for others, this is just the start of that incredible journey.
This is a special place for one Irish writer as we celebrate their unique place in our literature and the industry will recognise a major international best-selling author.
So it looks like we are in for a great night. Do stay tuned to the UNPUS Irish Book Awards 2019.
Be involved in a night like this, even just to attend, it's lovely.
Sometimes you can get kind of crippled by fear about it, but if you just go for it.
A great night out here and it's good for the book as well.
Event of the year for the book business. I think if you're a writer, everyone aspires to being here.
Really, that kind of validation is important.
You don't know it's going to become published and you certainly don't expect to be getting into the tuxedo list.
Fantastic point along the road of the journey of writing a book.
I couldn't have asked for a better co-author than Paul Howard. He has been fantastic.
Just a really nice acknowledgement, I think, after all the work. It's not necessary, it's not the be-all and end-all, but it's definitely a lovely feeling.
Just an indication that people are still reading it and still enjoying what you do, and that's always a nice thing.
I mean, Ireland is so blessed with writers and talent.
One day a year you get the chance to get dressed, you know, and to kind of smarten yourself up a bit.
Constantly gasping around corners going, this person.
Basically like the writer's Christmas party, so that's why I love it so much.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're all really welcome to the 2019 UNPUS Irish Book Awards. The fine dining is over. The voters are in, and in a moment we'll reveal the winners in these Your National Book Awards. All of us gathered here appreciate the energy, the creativity, and the sacrifices authors make to bring us these wonderful books, and tonight we salute you all. I feel truly honoured to be a part of these awards, and in just a few moments we'll announce the first winner of the evening. But first, please welcome Evelyn O'Rourke, who has the privilege of interviewing some of our winning authors backstage tonight. Evelyn.
Yes, I'm here in the interview suite and I'm dying to see what authors you're going to send our way this evening. And you're right, it is such a privilege to get to interview these brilliant writers, some of whom are just in the first flush of success, and I'm looking forward to it immensely.
Thanks, Evelyn. Look, we look forward to updates from you throughout this evening. Well, just before we begin the awards, it's worth remembering that books, they're nothing without readers. This is your night as much as ours. So thank you for reading, thank you for voting, and we hope you'll enjoy tonight's show. Now to the first award of the evening. It's the RT Radio 1 Listener's Choice Award. Earlier this year, Ryan Tubridy, Sean O'Rourke, Ray Darcy, Joe Duffy and myself, we were asked to choose and champion a book that had resonated with us over the past 12 months during our radio shows. We invited listeners to vote, and the response, it was truly phenomenal. You, the Radio 1 listeners, you chose your favourite from these five shortlisted books.
Night Boat to Tangier by Kevin Barry. Girl by Edna O'Brien. Shadow Play by Joseph O'Connor. Overcoming by Vicky Phelan with Naomi Linehan. Once, Twice, Three Times an Aisling by Emer McLysett and Sarah Breen.
And the winner of the RTE Radio 1 Listener's Choice Award is Overcoming by Vicky Phelan.
I don't know if anybody saw my tweet earlier, but my son was hoping I'd be coming home with a cup like the Champions League trophy. It's another piece of glass, unfortunately, Dara. I wrote the book for my kids, for Amelia and Dara. This is for you. Thank you very much.
Before you leave us, Vicky, as you know, Ray Darcy championed your book, and he would dearly love to have been here tonight to give this award to you in person. Unfortunately, he's at work in Studio 4 tonight, and he wasn't able to come, but he sent you a very special message.
Congratulations, Vicky. Well done. Truly well deserved. Overcoming tells your amazing life story. Everyone knows by now how you spoke the truth to power and you stood up for your rights and the rights of thousands of Irish women, and how you refused to be gagged during the cervical check controversy. Of course, in the book, we also find out where you got your strength from. We find out about the many tragedies you overcame throughout your life, and they've all made you the powerhouse that we know today. Dara and Amelia and all your family must be very, very proud of you. And we as a country are very lucky to have you. Well done again. Congratulations and have a brilliant night.
And our heartiest congratulations from all of us at RT Radio 1 to the wonderful Vicky Phelan.
I'm joined now by Vicky Phelan, who is the winner of the RTE Radio 1 Listener's Choice Award. It's very hard for us to believe now that you only sort of burst into our lives in April 2018. Yeah. We feel like we know you so kind of well. You know, your life before then and after that, as you sit here now reflecting on it, what thoughts are running through your mind?
I'm still just a normal mammy. You know, I still bring the kids to school, make the lunches, you know, do the normal stuff that everybody does. And I don't dress like this at home. But
you don't wear eyeliner all the
time. No, absolutely. No, I don't wear makeup when I'm at home. Very rarely, you know.
Still putting on the washes.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. You know, I mean, and for me, that's important. I like to be able to do all the normal stuff. And they're actually the things you miss when you're sick. Mm. You know, when you're stuck in bed and you're not able to get out of bed and you've had all the treatment and you're puking, you know, 3 and 4 times a day. Mm. For me, it's great to be able to get up and get out the door and to be able to bring the kids to school and to come to something like this and not be in pain and not be, you know, feeling that, you know, this might be the last kind of thing that I come to. Do you know what I mean? Because there's always that thing at the back of my mind, well, you know, I'm always kind of looking a few weeks down the line, kind of wondering, well, you know, I don't plan too far ahead because you can't, because you don't want to be disappointed.
So did writing the book help you work through at all what you've been through?
I really wrote the book for my kids, particularly my son, Dara, who's only 8, because he hates it that I'm always gone. You know, I'm gone to Dublin. And every time I come up here or I'm gone to do some kind of an event, I have to explain to him where I'm going. Okay. And sure, all you get is the face, you know, and he's like, oh, you have to go again. And when are you going to be back, Mum? And he doesn't really understand why I'm doing all this. Mm. Obviously, he's still only 8. So for me, the book is a way for him to understand when he's old enough to read it. Mm. Why Mammy was always in Dublin if I'm not here to tell him that. Do you know what I mean? Or why I'm doing all the stuff I'm doing, or why I'm always on the radio or on the television or whatever, you know.
I suppose, you know, we know as you being somebody who's in the middle of this sort of the greatest medical scandal really in recent years, it seemed to me reading the book that, and I know you've said you wrote it for your son, but it feels to me that you're possibly also writing it to, you know, for Emma and for Irene Teep and to make sure that those stories are kind of recorded. It's almost like you're possibly getting the chance to tell the story.
Yeah, and I did.
That they haven't had a chance to tell.
Yes. Yeah, and I was very conscious of that because I wanted to include, you know, little bits about the women who have died, like Stephen's wife, Irene, and Emma, and Tracy, who died last year, Tracy Brennan, because I got quite close to Tracy and I really wasn't expecting her to die. And her death hit me very hard because that came on the back of Laura Brennan had just died in March. And then Ruth Morrissey's case had just finished and she was ended up, and Ruth and myself are very good friends because we live literally a mile away from each other. I mean, it's crazy when you think about it. So we see each other very regularly. And she was in a hospice, you know, literally when her case finished, she ended up in hospice for 5 weeks and I'd been visiting her. And then, you know, when I was on the way out to Laura Brennan's Month's Mind, because I couldn't go to her funeral because I was in hospital, I got news that Tracy Brennan had just died. So I had a really rough couple of weeks where, you know, a number of women who had been quite close to me died. And it was, for me, it was very important to talk about those.
And the power of this book as well is in the title, Overcoming. Mm. You know, not overcame, overcoming.
Yeah.
That maybe talking to you now, I get a sense of, for you, it's just daily.
Yeah, it is. It is daily, yeah. So there's always, you know, and in fairness, I don't kind of sit around thinking too much about the bad stuff. You know, if it comes, you deal with it. And if I have a few bad days, you know, I don't let it get to me too much. I do worry, you know, I mean, I'm only human. But at the same time, you know, once it passes, then I'm fine and I start planning for the next thing, you know. And that's the way, you know, you should be living your life, you know. Because I know myself, I suppose, from past experiences that I haven't always dealt with things very well. And that was one of the other things, you know, that I wanted to get across in the book. Because I did feel that there was a kind of an element there, especially when I meet people. Yeah. They think I'm this superwoman and I'm kind of, oh, Jesus, I'm not, you know. I'm just a normal mammy and, you know, I was just put in an extraordinary situation. And I just, you know, did the right thing. And I'm very stubborn and I wouldn't have backed down. And that's it, do you know what I mean? And I suppose, you know, a lot of people kind of say to me, but you could have just went away and, you know, not dealt with all of this. And I said, yeah, if I was a different person, possibly. But I suppose once numbers started growing, I mean, at that stage, I only knew there were 14 women by the time my court case settled. And then the numbers started racking up every day and I could not step away.
Well, it just seems to me, reading the book and the reaction in the room tonight, you're so loved. Yeah. And people trust you so much, and we're just so grateful you came along and made that extra effort to join us this evening. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much. I'm really delighted to be here and delighted to get my award. So I can relax now.
Take it with you now.
I will. Yeah, it's all welcome.
Well, now, raising literacy levels is really important to everyone connected to the world of books. OnPost has supported the National Adult Literacy Agency in providing literacy, numeracy and digital tuition to adults and families for more than a decade. At this point, we'd like to introduce you to a truly extraordinary person who has been on an inspiring journey back into the world of adult education. This is Veronica's story.
I left school at 12 years of age. I'm returning to finish off an education I never got to do.
It's such a nervous thing to do, to walk into a place of learning, maybe having had a very small amount of experience within a learning environment. It's hugely brave on the part of anyone who walks through that door there.
I want to learn. I want to be able to go out there and meet all types of people and be able to talk to them about all types of stuff.
NAL is a charity and we are dedicated to improving the numeracy, literacy and digital literacy skills of adults in Ireland.
That first half of the page.
What NALA tried to do is make sure that those opportunities and those pathways are ready and waiting for you when you need them or when you want them.
It's a song of hope.
Veronica never got the opportunity to fulfil her potential, so I think she will give this her all. On poster sponsoring the Irish Book Awards, and we're hoping that you might present an award.
Okay.
Yeah, good woman.
I've never wrote a speech in my life. I'm nervous, but I like to try new things.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Veronica Poole.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's my great pleasure to be here this evening. My name is Veronica Poole, and I'm 62 years old. I left school at 12 years of age to support my family because my father had become critically ill. I have returned to school 50 years on because my son wanted to see me doing more with my life, and so did I. I had watched NALA ads for 2 years, and eventually my son said to me, get out, go back to school, it's your time to learn. So I contacted NALA, and I am on my 10th week back to school in Clostradulach in Coolock. I'm taking maths and English, and it is truly amazing. I would love if my story could help other people to return to school. Maybe someday I'll be back here getting an award for a book I've written.
You will.
My message is it's never too late to return to school because life is about a long life process of learning. And yes, you can.
Absolutely wonderful. You're going to stay with me, Veronica, I think, because you are going to have me present the next award, which is the Book Selling Ireland Non-Fiction Book of the Year. 6 fascinating books of biography, history, travel, essays, and political analysis. They make up the shortlist in this year's category. The 2019 nominations are...
Elsewhere by Rosita Boland. Heroic Failure by Fintan O'Toole. Republic of Shame by Caelan Hogan. Constellations by Sinead Gleeson. The Border, The Legacy of a Century of Anglo-Irish Politics by Dermot Ferriter. The Education of an Idealist by Samantha Power.
Veronica, our winner, please.
The winner of the Book Selling Ireland Non-Fiction Book of the Year, Constellations, by Sinead Gleeson.
I'd better say thank you, Irla and Maeve, my children, in case they cut this bit out for the telly, because they're more excited than I am about this. Every writer in this room knows that we need booksellers and readers to champion us, and we'd be nowhere without them. And I want to thank those hugely. And because this is also a huge room full of people who love books, my book is about a lot of things. It's about love and death and illness and bodies. There's some funny bits as well. It's not a total buzzkill book. But I think it's mostly about empathy. Good night.
Congratulations to Sinead, thanks John, and well done to Veronica in particular for sharing her story with us tonight.
Well, I'm joined now by Sinead Gleeson, winner of Bookselling Ireland Non-Fiction Book of the Year category. Sinead, huge congratulations on your win this evening.
Thanks, Evelyn.
You and those old bones of yours are collecting the awards. I know. Just tell us a little bit about the book itself, because the title Constellations, obviously, about, you've talked about the fact that you're trying to tell maybe the map or the story of the map of all the scars, all the marks in your body and how they've made you the woman you are today and the writer you are today. Yeah. Tell us a little bit about that.
It's a book of essays, so it's about a lot of different subjects. So I do take one of my big themes, I think, is the body, because I've had a lot of bad luck with mine. You know, I have a hip replacement, leukemia. Lots of awful things have happened. I managed to have children after having loads of chemotherapy. So I feel in lots of ways very lucky, but I feel like I'm the owner of a very badly misbehaving body in lots of ways. So a constellation, I guess the title is, constellation is, you know, think of Orion and it's one big thing, but it's made up of loads of distinct stars. So you could read one of these essays or you could read all of them or you can read them in different orders. So that's kind of what, a bit of a shorthand for what the book is.
I think it's interesting you're saying that. I think when I picked it up, I was looking forward to it, but I didn't expect it to be so kind of page-turny.
Thanks for saying that.
Yeah, but there was a real rhythm to it. And I thought, was that very important to you, that you'd hook the reader in, that it wasn't just going to be a dip in and out, that once you got us, that was it, you were going to unfurl this story?
Yeah, I wanted to tell it in a very specific way. And I think I was approached by a publisher a few years ago about writing a memoir when they'd seen something I'd posted online. And I thought, I don't want to write a book that's all about death or all about illness or all about sad things, because I'm interested in loads of things. And a book like this is a way of funneling all the things that you're interested in and sort of whirling them all around in a sort of mad tombola.
I think for me, I was at the launch with Anne Enright and she so brilliantly said, you know, for those of us who love Sinead, this is going to be a tough read, because there is such darkness in the book. What do you make of those kind of observations? How do they help you as a writer?
Yeah, there's definite darkness, but I always find, I mean, I teach writing to students and I always say you've got to go where the raw stuff and the difficult stuff is, because that is the stuff that people actually respond to the most, because it's the stuff we're all just trying to get by in life. And if you read somebody else's experience of grief or loss or pain or illness, it makes you feel less alone when you do read those stories. I think that's why we read that kind of work. So I've heard loads of those stories from readers at events and it's made me kind of feel better that my experience has helped them, or that my experience has been not as bad as theirs or been a bit better than theirs. And you feel a kind of solidarity. And that's what reading is in general. We all know it connects us all. Stories connect us all.
Now, it's not our first time meeting here. You've won twice before. Yeah. But of course, they are for anthologies that you edited.
Yeah.
Tonight, you're sitting here winning this award sort of for your own writing. That must be gratifying in a different way.
When you write a book yourself, you are putting yourself out there, especially a book like this that is quite open-hearted and does reveal an awful lot. It was in a category with a load of people I really admire. So I just wanted to come along for the night, and when they announced it, I feel really thrilled. For your own writing, it's really thrilling. I'm so delighted.
Congratulations again.
Now we come to the En Poste International Recognition Award. This award, reserved for distinguished international authors, was presented by Maria Dickinson from the Irish Book Awards and Aoife Byrne, En Poste Chief of Staff. This year's recipient was Game of Thrones creator George R.R. Martin, who was presented with his award on the 20th of August. Here's a short video reminder of that very special night in the GPO.
We are delighted to welcome George R.R. Martin to this historic building and this beautiful setting to receive the En Poste Irish Book Awards 2019 International Recognition Award.
Quite a thrill for me to be here and to accept this award. I've been told a little about it and some of the previous winners of it, and I always think the people who have gotten an award, the company you keep is always a very important part. And so I'm thrilled to have been included in this company and to receive it in this place, the Irish Alamo. being in this building, infused with its enormous sense of history, and knowing the men who fought here and the men who died here in the names of having the right to govern themselves, having the right for freedom, is a very moving experience. And before we started here, they took me on a tour and showed me some of the exhibits around here. And I had known some of the history myself, of course, because I do read a lot of history, as I said, but still, it was profound to see it here. So thank you so much for bringing me here to this place and for giving me this award. It means a lot. Thank you.
Next up is the journal.ie Best Irish Published Book of the Year, which, as the name suggests, prizes not just a book's content, but also its aesthetic qualities. There are some fabulous books on this year's shortlist, so let's take a look at the nominations.
The Great Irish Science Book by Luke O'Neill and illustrated by Linda Fairlin. Children of the Troubles by Joe Duffy and Freya McClements. Dare to Dream, Irish People Who Took on the World and Won, by Sarah Webb and illustrated by Graham Corcoran. Beautiful Affair by Mike Hanrahan. Ireland Through Birds, Journeys in Search of a Wild Nation by Connor W. O'Brien. A History of Ireland in 100 Words by Sharon Arbuthnot, Moira Niwaney, Gregory Toner, and illustrated by Joe McLaren.
Sinead, the winner, please.
And the winner of the journal.ie Best Irish Published Book of the Year is Children of the Troubles by Joe Duffy and Freya McClements.
On this day, the Universal Day of Children, November 20th, we remembered 186 children who were killed as a result of the conflict in Northern Ireland. They were killed in Northern Ireland, they were killed in this city, they were killed in Sligo, they were killed in Cavan, they were killed all across Northern Ireland, the UK, and indeed Germany. This book should never have had to be written. It was written. This book, as far as we're concerned, pivots on one quote from one parent, which reflected the quotes from all parents and families. And that was, the bullet, it was from Jack Kennedy about his son, James Kennedy. He said, "The bullet that killed my son still has not stopped traveling." Bullets do not stop traveling in distance, and they do not stop traveling in time. Explosions do not stop reverberating. And if there's one lesson, if there is a lesson on the stories of this book, is that our combined intelligence of politicians, diplomats, statesmen and women, journalists, civil servants, writers, citizens, our 100% effort should always be into avoiding conflict and to avoiding violence. And that is the lesson from this book. Gura míle maith.
Well, congratulations, Joe and Freya, on winning the journal.ie Best Irish Published Book of the Year. Reading through the book, there are obviously so many moving stories in it, but reading around it, it seems to me that maybe a story like Philip Rafferty's seems to be one that haunts you in particular. Would you mind just recalling that story for us?
Yeah, well, Philip Rafferty was a 14-year-old boy, just turned 14, and grown up in West Belfast in 1973, early January 1973, and he was in a band. He loved music, and he was in a band, and he was making his way home from the band this evening, and his mother had warned him to be careful because they were shooting out of cars. Loyalist gangs were firing out of cars, just in a purely sectarian attempt to kill Catholics, and Philip was on his way home, and he was abducted from the street, and he was taken to the outskirts of Belfast, and he was tortured, and his hood was put over his head, and he was murdered, and His mother, Maureen, wonderful, wonderful lady, in her 80s now, still lives in West Belfast. And she was one of the very first people that we interviewed as part of the book. And she said to me, and I always remember it because she said to me, she said, nobody knows my Philip's name. She said, they took a boy from the street, put his hood over his head and murdered him. And I think the world should know these things.
Jo, you were with us a few years ago when your previous book, The Children of the Rising, won in 2015, all the way back then. And now you're back with this book. What does winning this award mean to you then? What kind of affirmation is it for you?
It's an affirmation really for the families who participated in the book, the families who have grieved for so long. They've never forgotten their children, obviously, every single day, every single minute. A lot of the children have been publicly forgotten. So the book, and it's a lovely presentation by Hachette, they've invested a lot in it. The book is, I think, a dignified, respectful memoriam to those 186 children. And it was apt on the Universal Day of Children that the book got the award. So it's for those children and for those families.
In terms of the reaction to the book, Freya, for you as a journalist, you know, it was real old-fashioned journalism. You had to make cold calls, dig through the archives. It must be gratifying now that people are responding so enthusiastically to it.
High officials, I suppose, ministers of state, you know, have come and told us how important they feel this book is. But at the same time, for us, really, again, it's been the families. And one of the things that was really, really moved me at the first launch of the book was in Belfast, and we were making the speeches, and I could just see the relatives, just they were hugging the books close, and the number of families who came up to us and said things like, you know, it's so important now that you know, my son has been remembered or my daughter has been remembered. You know, you can't right a wrong, but yes, there's something in the acknowledgement that I think seems to have made a real difference to people, and it's been a privilege, certainly on my part, and I know that Jo feels the same, that we've been able to do this. And again, this award is just another part of that in terms of letting people know about the children, making sure that their names aren't forgotten.
Likewise. Well, it's a really interesting partnership in terms of authoring a book, and you're still on speaking terms, so that's always good.
Yeah.
Thank you, and go off and enjoy your evening. Huge congratulations.
Thank you.
Nish to Bradham Love, Lar Grelga, Lar Grelga na Blain a la Bruna. Sean Dara Blain, Egon Gatagor Shah Vetlin, Darga Hinta Clashinurik, Tom Weed Haravep Weep, the Love Lar Grelga, August Duris na Grelga, Os Oct Aguid Uriokta, August Nish, Shahid na Hanam Nukhan, Don Gatagor Shah.
Goira in Egg by Sean Amuragon, Gronya Gashkir Gail by Siobhan Parkinson. Maravir Dus by Joe Steve O'Nachtan. Tarngrecht by Prunchius McAward. Kitty Nagorthy by Railton Ní Lanon. An Trumghav by Fergal O'Bara.
Bortor Love Lear Gaelge. Lear Gaelge na Bliana, Tarang Nroch le Princess Mac Award.
I'm very, very pleased and honoured to receive this award tonight. And I accept it with immense gratitude, but also with a touch of sorrow. I come from a small island community in Donegal, and we were hit very badly last Sunday when a young man was drowned, and he was buried this today. So normally at home, an award like this would be a community celebration, and it wouldn't be an individual achievement, but a community celebration, there'd be community excitement and whatnot. But my family, my community are heartbroken at the minute. So we will celebrate this. We will celebrate it, but just not tonight. Good meeting, meeting, my good evening.
On now to the Specsavers Children's Book of the Year, Junior. As every parent knows, the books you read to your children, they remain forever imprinted on our minds and on theirs. And in years to come, some of the books on this year's shortlist will be remembered just as fondly. Let's hear the nominations.
The President's Surprise by Peter Donnelly. Boot, Small Robot, Big Adventure by Shane Hegarty and illustrated by Ben Mantle. Don't Worry, Little Crab by Chris Houghton. Tiny and Teeny by Chris Judge. 1-2-3 Ireland by Aoife Dooley. Take 5 by Niall Breslin and illustrated by Sheena Dempsey.
And the winner of the Specsavers Children's Book of the Year Junior is 1-2-3 Ireland by Aoife Dooley.
I'm not going to lie, I didn't really prepare anything because I didn't think there was a chance in hell this something like this was going to happen. For a working class autistic woman to be holding something like this, talking back to you, it's a big deal for me.
Well, our next award is the National Book Tokens Popular Fiction Book of the Year. These are the books that everyone talks about, the books which populate the bestseller displays in every bookshop across this country. 6 extremely popular writers have made this year's shortlist. Let's take a look.
Once, Twice, Three Times an Aisling by Emer McLysett and Sarah Breen. Filter This by Sophie White. Postscript by Cecilia Hearn. When All Is Said by Anne Griffin. Schmidt Happens by Ross O'Carroll Kelly. 7 Letters by Sinead Moriarty.
The winner of the National Book Tokens Popular Fiction Book of the Year is Once, Twice, Three Times an Aisling, Emma McLysett and Sarah Green.
So much so that we had 3 drinks before we got here, so...
We had 18 drinks.
Stop, up Sarah! We really didn't expect this.
Yeah.
I'd like to thank you, Sarah.
I thank you.
It's not every day you get to work with your best friend and then win an award with her, so well done.
Well done to you.
Thank you.
Congratulations again,
thank
Emer
you.
And Sarah,
thank
the creations
you.
Of Aisling, of course, who we all love. You know, Aisling's like, sure, at this point you're Megan, you know, it's the one name phenomenon thing. How does it feel to create an Aisling?
It feels amazing.
Increasingly more unbelievable, because we have so many people coming up to us every day saying, I know Aisling and I am Aisling, my mum is Aisling and I'm, you know, my cousin's Aisling. And, you know, Sarah and I just still feel like the same old friends at Men College. Well, we can't believe it.
We're taking it on and we're like, okay, that's fine. Yeah.
Owning it.
Yeah,
all the time. Yeah.
I suppose what's interesting for you guys is, you know...
That's like, you know, married couple.
I just want to point that out, but, you know...
It's a big night for us.
Yeah.
You don't have to hold hands the whole way through, but if that feels
well,
better...
Well, what if we just do?
You own it. Because, you know, I think Aisling would think that was a bit notion-y, to be honest, but,
well,
you know...
Well, whatever.
Tell me about writing her. You know, you're now, obviously, three times an Aisling, and we're going to get 2 more instalments about Aisling. So... You're also bringing her to life on screen.
Yeah.
Aisling and yourselves, you're busy ladies. Tell us about where all of that is at for you.
We are. Well, when we first wrote Aisling, our first book, we never, never imagined that it was going to go beyond that. We thought our mums would read it, our friends would read it, and that would be it. And now we are heading into doing 5 books in total. We've won this for the 3rd book, which we're absolutely delighted about because we were so nervous about it because, you know, the first book was a success. People were really anxious about the second one. They loved it. And then the 3rd, and we were like...
With every book that happens, people are... more and more invested in the character. Yeah.
And you're more worried that it's going to be not
as good. Well, the stakes are higher in a way because people feel they own her now. And you're not to mess it up. You know, don't mess it up on me, kind of.
And we've supported each other, I think, a lot through the process, but this year more so than ever. We've supported each other a lot and it has even made us better friends and better workmates.
I think so.
We weren't expecting to win this award, so it's amazing.
So Aisling has gone home on this one, back to BGB, Ballygobackward
or Ballygobbard.
And she's in a WhatsApp group. you know, which is the bane of my life and most people I know. So
she's
are you always looking for comic potential? Like WhatsApp was perfect.
I'm 38. Like, who hasn't been in WhatsApp? Every time I go home to the country, something, you know, big is happening. Like, you know, someone's been invited to a wedding. Yeah. It's in the location of a mart. What's going to happen? Like, that literally happened
to my does know somebody who got married in a mart recently.
But weekend.
In an ironic way, I presume.
No. It was just like a space.
It's a great space.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Come home.
A lot of fresh air.
A girl can dream. Okay, well, listen, congratulations again on winning this award. We love Aisling. More of her, please.
Thank you very much.
Well, look, at this point in the evening, we pause to remember the very many distinguished members of the Irish literary community who left us in 2019. Suvnis Shiri Urhu Gulair. And this brings us to the Ireland AM Popular Non-Fiction Book of the Year, a category which frequently produces many of the blockbusting bestsellers of the Christmas season. Here are the nominations.
My Crazy World by Christy Dignam with Damien Corliss. Overcoming by Vicky Phelan with Naomi Linehan. Barefoot Pilgrimage by Andrea Corr. The Personals by Brian O'Connell. Live While You Can by Father Tony Coote. The Making of a Detective by Pat Murray.
Your winner is Andrea Corr.
There's nothing in my head to say. I'm so thrilled. I'm so thrilled to even be in this room, never mind to have this in my hand. Oh, God, my husband, Brett, my two children, Jeannie and Brett, my sisters and my brother, Sharon, Jim and Caroline, my mum and dad, Jean, and I share this award with my father, Jerry. Congratulations, Daddy. Oh. Thank you.
Oh. Andrea Corr, huge congratulations on winning your award. I mean, you've had such success over, 40 million records, but all of that was kind of a group effort with the family. The idea of writing this book on your own, very nerve-wracking, daunting prospect. I presume it's kind of gratifying to win this then?
It's amazing to win it. I'm really so emotional and grateful about it. I can't quite believe it. To be honest, like in my life, I'm not much of a winner. I've lost more than I've won. I don't mean that, but I mean when it comes to award ceremonies. So I didn't expect it, but I'm so grateful for it. I'm so grateful for it.
It's incredibly moving. I mean, you talk about your brother, your three-year-old brother. Yeah. I don't want to upset you, but in terms of just recalling that time, you write very movingly about him. He comes to life on the page.
I wish I'd thanked him down there and I didn't, but then, yeah. You know, Jared was killed on the road. In the first week, Sharon was brought home from the hospital as a new baby. He ran out after a ball. It's this tragedy and this ghost that was in our house. I had to include that because that's what was in our house. In some ways, I'm glad to kind of give him life again, to bring him into our story, the person in the band that you never saw, but he was there. And that's what was in Mum and Dad. And that's why we were so precious as well, I think.
We knew obviously about your mum and your dad because obviously we all thought we knew you in a way in those times. But you made that decision to write about the miscarriages, for example.
Yes.
And you weren't sure you were going to do that. But the book, at that point, you were so immersed in being a writer, it felt like you had to.
Well, you know what? The thing is that I love books. And I like this, that's, you know, I also listen to audiobooks all the time. I've got headphones in my head all the time. And I'd say people think I'm listening to music, but I'm not. I'm listening to an audiobook. And what I found is that every book, whether it's fiction or non-fiction, is about the evolution of a life, right? So you've got an evolution in some way. So I could not leave out five miscarriages and be truthful about my own evolution, because it is a spiritual evolution. Mm-hmm. And that's a huge part of it.
It's quite humbling to see how much winning this book award means to you. It's very inspiring for us as readers.
It's because I am a reader myself. Okay. And I know what it means that I've been voted for here and that I've won this tonight. I know that it's real. I know that I in some ways think the book world's a tad more honest than the music world.
Just a tad.
Let's just say just a little bit. But like, let's make. Yeah. So to be sitting here talking to you having won it is massive. For Dad's poetry to be in this and my dad to have won this award is what I really feel tonight. That's why I'm saying I'm sharing it with my dad. Also, I contrary to what you might think, I am much more used to losing than winning. I do remember one time in like school and there was like goldfish. If you got so many things at the sports day events, you'd get the goldfish. The person eventually gave up and went like, please just give her the goldfish. I can't bear it. She's just not winning. So I actually, that's me. It's like
You didn't kill the goldfish,
did you? I get given the goldfish because I can't win it. I generally, like, it's very rare that I win things. Like, I'm really pleased.
It'll be in pride place. I promise we won't come back looking for it. It's yours for keeps.
Thank you so much.
Well done again. Congratulations.
Thank you.
We come now to the penultimate trophy of this year's Unpost Irish Book Awards, the Bob Hughes Lifetime Achievement Award. This year's recipient has occupied a central position in the cultural life of Ireland for over three decades. He is a quintessentially Irish writer, greatly beloved here in his own country for his work, his intellect, his wit, and his very warm disposition. Let's hear more about the 2019 Lifetime Achievement winner.
In my view, he is the great contemporary Irish writer. And that's what Colm is. He is of our time, but he's also timeless in terms of his themes, of his characters.
He's very good on sort of the quiet dailiness of life, I think. His books tend not to be full of event, but what you get from them is this kind of wonderful submersion into this daily, quiet world.
There's a musicality in Colm. And Colm always begins with an image, but with that image comes a sound that's very original, very his. And I appreciated and understood and respected, because that's how Beckett wrote, and Joyce. I feel extremely proud of Pale Sister, and feel so fortunate to have had an opportunity to work with a mind like his and a person like him.
Colm is probably one of the most entertaining people to know. He's a wonderful conversationalist. Back in the day, we were rookie journalists, writers, would-be writers together. Later, when, you know, he published his first novel, I was so surprised and delighted by it, because it revealed a side of Colm that I had never really seen properly, you know? Very grave, very serious, very profound.
The South stood out as something that was remarkable and was heralding what would be, and has subsequently proven to be, a remarkable career. Colm, as a journalist, just had this incredible eye and this incredible ear. And I think that came across very strongly in his non-fiction books, like A Walk Along the Border. And I remember promoting it in Waterstones in Regent Street. And I think it's the journalist in him which gives him that absolute sensitivity and awareness and interest in people, places, ideas.
I love Brooklyn. It's probably his most achieved novel. It's very understated.
I read Brooklyn on an aeroplane, and the air hostess had to keep coming over to me to see if I was okay, because I was crying so violently that I was gasping the whole way through the the flight.
And to present the Bob Hughes Lifetime Achievement Award, please welcome Fintan O'Toole of the Irish Times.
Good evening, friends and fellow readers. Colm Devine, as you know, was born in 1955 in Enniscorthy in County Wexford. And like so many of our great writers who come from relatively small communities, he learned early that skill, I suppose, you only really get in small places, which is the capacity to feel that you can observe every single thing that's going on those streets, and even begin to imagine what's going on behind those closed doors. Colm Devine, in one way, is one of the great heirs of James Joyce. What James Joyce did at the beginning of the 20th century was to say in the most brilliant way that there's nothing in the universe more interesting, more complex, and more mysterious than what's going on in the human mind. The so-called ordinary person doesn't exist. What's in the brain of people who are not noticed, who may not be famous, who may not be heroes, has a complexity and a beauty and a dynamism that is far beyond anything that we see in the constellations in the sky. Colm Devine is one of the great astronomers of that interior universe. When you read him, what you're struck with again and again and again is this extraordinary capacity to give you this sense of the wonderful richness of every human life, and therefore, of course, of the uniqueness and preciousness of human life. He's an extraordinarily democratic writer in the sense that if you think about his characters, there's no difference in complexity between the so-called anonymous shop girl who emigrates from Enniscorthy to Brooklyn, and the High Court judge, between the young man who's dying of AIDS and the Blessed Virgin Mary, you know, between the Greek hero and the lonely widow in you know, 1960s Ireland. Each human mind is treated by this artist with a profound respect for human preciousness and individuality. What he does in giving us that vivid, brilliant sense of the richness of human life is, of course, to enhance our own lives. And that's what our great artists do. That's why Colm Devine is an absolutely worthy winner of the Lifetime Achievement Award.
And I'd just like to ask David back up on stage, please, to present the award. Thanks.
Overwhelmed. I was even a bit overwhelmed when I heard I was getting this. A bit surprised, delighted. And so I thought, I was down at home and I was so delighted that I met a fellow I was in school with, someone I never really liked. And I told him all about the award. And I told him about all the other people who had won the award. I went through all the names and, you know, generally it was great. And just wouldn't be stopped until he said to me, you know that award? And I said, yeah, that's the one I was telling you about, you know, that I richly deserve. And he said, would there be any chance that there might be a message in the award, like lifetime achievement and stuff, that like there might be someone in Dublin who thinks maybe that if you could stop, like you could let other people in or you could just get out of the way generally. He looked at me like, I thought, well, there was no answer to that. So I thought about it for a while, and I went through all the... I mean, I wondered, like, if you stopped, would there be sort of an outcry or riots, and what would it mean to the world, you know? And I thought, well, there'd be no more sort of sad novels about Enniscorthy and growing up there, and I thought that would be some loss. There'd be no more making an aegis of myself in interviews and offending about a quarter of the nation and on Twitter, and God almighty, and there'd be no more bad plays. There'd be no more efforts to write sort of Greek characters. There'd be no more me pretending that I knew about the inner lives of young women in the 1950s. And generally, there really wouldn't be any problem. So here it is. Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you for one vote. Thank you.
Well, big congratulations to Colm and thanks to Fintan and David for presenting. Finally, ladies and gentlemen, we come to the Eason Novel of the Year, an award won in the recent past by some brilliant Irish writers, including Anne Enright, John Banville, Sebastian Barry and Emma Donoghue. Once again, it's been a banner year for literary fiction. All of the shortlisted titles have attracted huge critical acclaim, and any one of them would make a worthy winner. But alas, it can only be one winner. So for the last time tonight, I invite you to take a look at the nominations.
Night Boat to Tangier by Kevin Barry. Girl by Edna O'Brien. Shadow Play by Joseph O'Connor. This is Happiness by Niall Williams. The Narrow Land by Christine Dwyer Hickey. The River Capture by Mary Costello.
The winner of the Easton Novel of the Year is Shadow Play by Joseph O'Connor.
I want first of all to say what a privilege it is to be here tonight at this wonderful gathering, this wonderful celebration of one of the things that is so lovely about Ireland, which is our respect and our love for the culture of the written word. It is something that's so special about us. It's something that we need to treasure and respect. And so it's lovely to get together and to do that. Secondly, to say that any year that you have a novel that is shortlisted for the Irish Novel of the Year, it is a tremendous honour, because you know how high the standard is going to be. And I want to just salute my fellow authors in this category for the magnificent novels that they all wrote this year, and to say how proud I am for my book to be bracketed among them. You know, you grow up in Dublin, and my dad, who I mentioned, is from Francis Street, just down the river. To be here tonight on the banks of the Liffey. When you grew up in a city that was famous for its books, famous for its writers, and the stories filled the air, and to think that you'd be here one night on the banks of the Liffey to receive an award for your book is just the stuff of dreams. So thank you very much for that. I want to end by saying that I, with heartfelt love, I dedicate this award to my beloved Anne-Marie and our wonderful boys, James and Marcus. Thank you so much for this award. Thank you.
Well, that's it. Congratulations to Joseph, and indeed well done to all of tonight's winners, to our guests here in the Convention Centre, to you at home. We hope you've enjoyed watching tonight. It's been a great night at the An Post Irish Book Awards. Slán agus iad Giad Gruller.
Other winners tonight included Specsavers Children's Book of the Year Senior was won by Nora Patton and illustrated by Jennifer Farley for Shooting for the Stars.
Oh my God, I'm actually shaken. I dedicated the book to all of the people who've paved the way and to future generations to dream their own dreams and shoot for the stars.
Other Words for Smoke by Sarah Maria Griffin won the Department 51 at Easton Teen and Young Adult Book of the Year.
6 years ago today, I was in the Gutter Bookshop launching the first book that I ever wrote, Not Lost. So there's a very strange circularity to this. I'm very grateful to be here.
Nicole Flattery won the Writing.ie Short Story of the Year for Parrot.
It's the first Irish Book Award won by the Stinging Fly. And I don't want to embarrass Declan Mead, but I will say it's extremely well deserved.
Liz Stoll Writers Week Irish Poem of the Year was won by Audrey Molloy for Salt Rain.
The poem came around by the fact that Audrey's mum died with leukemia and Audrey couldn't make it to her funeral because she was heavily pregnant. But she came after her child was born, and this was her trip from the Dublin airport to the graveyard. And she says her dad never stopped talking for the whole journey.
A Voca Cookbook of the Year winner was Cornucopia by Tony Keogh, Aoife Carrigy, the chefs of Cornucopia, Deirdre and Doreena McCafferty.
The two of us worked together for the last nearly 20 years, and the vision of this cookbook brought this together. It's fantastic. Aoife, the co-author, all the amazing chefs in Cornucopia who work hard every day to help bring delicious foods out onto the counter and to help bring the book together.
The Bord Gáis Energy Sports Book of the Year went to Richie Sadlier with Dion Fanning for Recovering.
I had no idea what writing a book involved. It turns out writing a memoir is not the same as writing an 800-word column about a football match for a newspaper. But thankfully, I was surrounded and supported and working alongside people who knew exactly what they were doing, and I really want to thank them. A lot of them are here tonight.
Winner of the Irish Independent Crime Fiction Book of the Year was Jane Casey's Cruel Acts.
There are five other writers in this room who deserved to be standing here holding this. And there are about 18 other writers who should or could have been on the list. Irish crime writing is just amazing at the moment, and I'm incredibly honoured to have won this.
When All Is Said by Anne Griffin was the winner of the Sunday Independent Newcomer of the Year.
And lastly, to the readers, because you guys are what we're all here for. And thank you for taking Morris and for giving him such a great year. Thank you so much.
Don't forget that you can vote for your favourite book of the year by going onto our website on postirishbookawards.ie. But for now, from me, Evelyn O'Rourke, it's Slán agus Beannacht.